We've invited our panelists here today because they have amazing, extensive experience with at-risk and in-risk young people and adults. And we've asked them to come here as part of the storytelling process to really hear about their experience and to ask them to tell us a couple stories that directly in their first-person narrative that would really help us understand the work they do and who they serve. So as Andrea told you earlier, each one of them is gonna speak for about 10 minutes, tell us two or three stories, and then we're gonna have the be able to interview them, so to speak. So Tyson.
So good morning once again. So as I was saying, I've been teaching for Five Keys Charter School since 2003. And when it started, it was the first charter high school in the United States dealing with trying to interrupt this school to prison pipeline. And I'm originally from the Bay Area, born and raised in San Jose. As you all can see, I'm a black man. And my entire life, I did everything that I could do to avoid jails and prisons. Everything. Every day, I still do the same thing. We live in a time where if you pay attention to social media, if you pay attention to the news, it's a very interesting time in America. We see instances of police brutality, police violence. If you look and you're open, you know that we have a problem, and it's not a new problem. It's a problem that's been existing since colonial time in America. It's still with us. So my upbringing, my parents were both involved in the civil rights movement. My father was involved in a more political faction of that as well. So I was raised with a particular consciousness, and it influenced the way that I saw the world, the way that I experienced the world, and what I wanted to see as outcomes in the world. When I had an opportunity to start teaching, I never thought that I'd be in a jail or a prison, but the opportunity presented itself, and I said, if I really want to try to help people that I know in my community, that's a place that I need to be. Because as we all know, the people that I represent are the most overrepresented population in jails and prisons, period. When it comes to those that are being pushed out of school or dropping out of school or receiving the most low quality education, again, my group is the most overrepresented. So I knew that I could be relevant in that environment. So I went to the job interview. They pretty much gave me the job on site without really looking at my qualifications, but I was qualified as well. I had a difficult time mentally trying to move into the jail setting because, as I said, I tried to avoid jails and prisons my entire life. So when we actually had to start teaching, they gave me an option to actually teach at a facility that was slightly outside of the jail walls. So the men were brought outside the jail, then they were put up in this little annex area. And so I taught there for a few months before I was actually ready to go inside the jail. Because just the idea of like stepping inside that, hearing a door close and knowing that you're locked in that facility. Like you can't get out unless somebody's pushing a button for you. So it's a super highly controlled environment. But when I felt like I was ready to do that, I did that, and that was a transition, and I've been inside those walls ever since. And it's an important place for us to be because the challenges that the men and the women face, it's a matter of life and death. I can't tell you how many times I've had a student that I felt we've made progress with while they were in the school, but then in a matter of a couple weeks or a few months, I see a headline or some blurb on the news that says that this person is no longer with us. And as you heard in the piece, many of the men and the women that I encounter, they have families, they have children. And so it's imperative for us to find a way to try to interrupt this. So that's just some general context for my experience and what I see when I'm in there. Now, when it comes to dealing with my students, what I feel has been one of the most effective things in terms of like relating a story is consistency is extremely important. So being able to provide a very high quality educational experience in an environment that is not about valuing people. Like, if we're really honest, and not trying to knock the prison industrial complex, there are a lot of things that we can do about that, but jails and prisons are not about establishing the humanity of people. It's about trying to whittle that away as much as possible. And so in an environment that is not receptive to the wants and the desires of the human condition, trying to provide education in a place like that is a challenge, it's hard. And then add to that, many of the people in San Francisco jails, they haven't gone to court yet, or they're still dealing with their cases, so they're worried about that, they're stressed out about that. They might be stressed out about their family, about kids, about cousins. There's so many stressors that they have on their mind, on their backs, and then you're trying to help them get a high school diploma. And then in California, we're trying to figure out whether or not to get people to Casey or whether it needs to be Common Core in the classroom. So we have all these other things that we're juggling to try to make it a reality for them. So you put all that together and then you put some people in a classroom. And the way that we have approached our situation, we have compulsory education. So they have to go to class or else they're going to face some type of punishment. Most people are okay with that, but some people do push back against the system. But in that, when they come to class, high quality education and the consistency of being there every single day, because many of the people that we encounter, they felt people who have said that they're gonna do something for them or be there, and they've been failed by that. So the relationships that they were supposed to establish way back in elementary school or junior high school, that system failed them. The community that was supposed to support them and protect them and help them move in a different direction, that institution broke down. So it's important to, if we're gonna interrupt that, we have to be aware of that. Like, we can't fail these people anymore. If you're saying you're gonna do something, you have to follow through on that. And you have to follow through in a way that is relevant, reflects the rigor and cultural competency of that environment. You can't be in there and just spend money on the situation and think that that's gonna solve it. No, you have to immerse yourself in the struggles, the trials, the tribulations, the context, and then be aware of the possible outcomes. Like, it's for real, life and death. And there's a lot that's riding on that. So recently, I have been teaching at the women's facility, which is in downtown San Francisco. And the way that our school year is broken up, we teach about 7 semesters, and each semester is about 5 to 6 weeks, because the nature of the environment or the population is very transient. People come in, you know, they might have a court case coming up, and they might get bailed out, so you only have a certain amount of time to teach. So we have these 5 to 6 week semesters. So I was at the women's facility for about 2 to 3 semesters. And in that, you know, you build relationships and people get accustomed to your teaching style. And the biggest obstacle for our population is math. And especially like when we're trying to get people to pass the Casey. So I teach math, I also teach social studies. And so I was with a group of women and we were making a lot of progress getting them ready to start taking algebra. And then the following semester, my school had scheduled me to go to the other facility and teach the men, and talking about that consistency. And so the women who felt comfortable with my teaching method, when they were made aware that I was gonna be moving to another facility, they stationed or they established a little protest at the jail facility, and they raised these very important concerns, talking about, we have a good relationship with, they call me Amir. We have a good relationship with Amir. We think that he's a great teacher. We feel that he is best suited for helping us obtain our goal of learning algebra. And so they wrote letters, they petitioned, they were gonna boycott. I was like, hold up, you know. I wanted to make sure that my facility knew that I wasn't behind this. I'm just doing my job, right? But they fought for that because they knew that it was important for them to have a good relationship with their teacher, a teacher that they felt understood them and could listen to them and then help them move to where they were trying to go, which was, you know, learn algebra and eventually obtain their high school diploma. And that was a great experience to see that, to see them take initiative and take hold of their educational process and try to make that a reality for themselves. And I was honored that I was a part of that, to witness it, and then I'm there now, so the school listened to their petitions and their protests and said, okay, even though you were gonna be scheduled to go to this other place, we'll keep you here. And I'm happy to say that the women are learning algebra at a very high level right now. And that's actually what I would be doing right now, because the algebra class is our morning class. So they're a little mad or salty that I'm not there with them today. But it's a good thing. So in conclusion, I guess, being aware of the environment, being aware of the context, and I think representing that consistency, but it's a quality consistency. We have to, this, it's a dirty environment. Like, if you're gonna get your hands in this place, you're gonna come back and you're gonna see some stuff, it's gonna smell, you know? You can't be afraid of that, because that's what we have to do if we're really gonna try to be change agents and change makers in a place like that. And I think that's it. Thank you very much for listening.
Actually testing myself. Can you hear me okay? Okay, so panels are tough for me because I have a lot of energy and I'm used to like moving around, and I'm always gotta be careful not to bang people around me, and panels are kind of a little more calm than when you're doing a talk, right? So I'm gonna do my best to contain myself within this space. So if I jump outside of it, please forgive me. My name is Ashanti Branch. I'm born and raised in Oakland, California. I was raised by a single mother on welfare. My father died 3 months to the day before I was born. So I don't know if what your story is. You know, I don't know what was on the plate when you showed up in the world. And if I had a checklist in the womb, I would have chosen things very differently than the way they came out. I would have chose to live in a house. Nice neighborhood, two parents, regular meals. Like, I would have chosen some different things than what was provided for me, but no one gave me a choice. No one gave me an option. And so when I heard my brother, I was gonna say Amir, but Tyson. When I heard my brother Tyson talk, he opened up a lot of things for me. And I feel my heart beating really fast right now because like, I didn't know I was gonna go here with this part of the talk about the story. But I'm gonna tell you where I came from, and then I'm gonna tell you what I've done. So, born and raised in Oakland, school was tough. Education was tough. Like, from Oakland Unified School District, I grew up in that district from kindergarten, preschool, through high school. And when I got to college, that's when I really realized how much they had not done for me. Like, I had really good grades, excellent grades. When I got to college, I realized that my excellent grades didn't compare to excellent grades from somewhere else. Like, I worked hard. I did everything they told me to do, and more. When I got to college, they were like, okay, you got this 10-week semester, a quarter. I was at Cal Poly San Luis Obispo. They said, you have, you got 4 books to read. I'm like, well, hold on, that math doesn't work out. You said 10 weeks, there's 4 books. That's like 2 weeks per book. They're like, yeah. I'm like, who does that? Who reads a book in 2 weeks? Is that possible? Can your eyes actually move that fast to read a book in 2 weeks? Now, the other kids in the class, they're like, the college students, they're like, no problem. And I'm blown away. I'm like, what am I gonna do? Because in my school, you may read 1 book per semester or maybe 2 books per semester, but you can like read 10 pages a week and you take it slow. And I'm like, and I have other classes on top of this. So I got to college realizing that there was something wrong. I studied to be an engineer, graduated in civil engineering, and soon after, about 5 years, I realized that making the money was fun, but it wasn't where my heart was. Like, I was like, something is wrong. Like, why am I not happy? I grew up poor, making money should make me happy. Why am I not really, really happy? And I was upset about that. And so when it came to me that I was gonna become a teacher, I was kind of bitter because teachers don't make money. And I was like, I already lived the poor thing. I don't wanna do that again. I want to make money. And so when I became a teacher, I gave in. It called me. Started teaching at San Lorenzo High School. And I realized that in my classes, there were African-American Latino young men who were failing. Like, they weren't failing because they were having a hard time with the material and they couldn't get it. They were failing because, and where I could see, they weren't trying. And I was like, this is not going to work. Like, I did not leave all that money to now be broke and unsuccessful. So either I'm gonna go back to make money or I'm gonna figure this teaching thing out. And so I told this student, I invited them to lunch. I said, like, I'm gonna buy you lunch once a week and you teach me how to be a better teacher because something I need to learn because I'm doing something wrong. And so the Ever Forward Club started out of these lunchtime meetings. What I realized as I look back and as I think about what Brother Tyson said. My life was on a very different trajectory if you saw me in middle school. Like, if you saw me in middle school, you would say, this young man is about to be in trouble. So, seventh grade, I was being bullied. Somebody was taking my lunch money. You know, a young man who had just got out of juvenile hall. Now, when you're in Oakland growing up, if a seventh grader just got out of juvenile hall, like, that's a big deal. And whatever rumor they tell you about him is probably true. So this kid was like, you're going to give me your lunch money. I'm like, okay. Because I wasn't a fighter. I was raised by my mother. She didn't really teach me she didn't teach me no rough edge. She told me how to be very nice, how to be very kind, how to wash dishes, how to fold clothes. She didn't really teach me how to tell somebody what you need to tell them growing up in Oakland, like, really. And what I realized is that my life almost took another turn, but it wasn't until a teacher saw something in me to say, you know what, you're too smart to act like you're not. And she changed my life. And so I'm gonna tell you one story about my senior year, because I was on my way to college. Like, by the time I was a senior, I was ready. I was on my way to college. And when I think about how fine the line is between being free and being locked up. Senior in high school, I had not been accepted to Cal Poly yet, but I thought I was gonna be accepted. I was already done with the college process. And I came home, and my mom, I came home from wrestling practice, and I, you know, came in the house, and I heard my mom and my stepfather, her husband, arguing. And I said, they always argued, so I didn't really pay much attention, but this argument was a little bit more elevated because I heard my mom say, I wish you would put your hands on me. And so I was like, that's a different one. So I go turn the corner where their room is, and as I turn the corner, I see my mom hit the floor. Now, I'm a mama's boy, I'm 17, I'm angry. Like, I'm like, whew. Like, I just came back from wrestling practice, I'm like, we're about to go do homework, apply for some scholarships, and I just see my mom hit the floor. And so I don't know if you've ever been angry. Like, I don't know, like, I'm talking about, like, angry to the place where you would do something that, on a normal situation, a person wouldn't do. So let me tell you how angry I was. So all my friends, a lot of my friends were not on their way to college. So ran around the corner to one of those friends who was not on his way to college, and I told him, you give me a gun. Like, that's how angry I was. Like, it was in me to, like, be at that anger. Now, he's like, he laughed. He's like, what are you talking about? I'm gonna give you no gun. I'm like, either give it to me or I'm going around the corner to get it from someone else. He was like, are you great? What's going on? I said, I don't have time to talk about it. You give it to me. And I was in rage. I remember it very well because I can feel myself shaking right now. And so he gives it to me in a paper bag. I drive back to my house, in front of my house, on the wrong side of the street. And as I get ready to open the door, I've never held a gun. At this moment, I've definitely never shot one, but I was, in my mind, that was something bad was gonna happen in that moment. And when I opened the door, the pause between opening the door and grabbing the bag, I actually saw the Oakland Tribune, and I saw myself being marched down the steps. Like, that pause right there, I don't know what it was, you can call it God, higher power, whatever you call it, like, something let me see myself being marched down the steps in handcuffs, my mom standing behind me crying, college Brown senior, life over something that was, like, emotionally unable to be contained in words or in anything else. Like, I was gonna do something that absolutely unacceptable. And the young men I worked with in Ever Forward, when I started Ever Forward, it was because I saw young men who were smart, on their way, could be going anywhere they wanted to go in life, but because of these emotional barriers and things that were getting in their way, tripping them up, they were on their way to prison. And I don't know where I would be if I hadn't saw myself on my way to prison. Like, I always thought I was going to college until that day. Like, I saw that happen, and I just sat in my car and I cried. I don't know how long it was, but I went back to my friend's house. He's like, what do I need to do? I'm like, it's fine, I didn't do nothing. But what we do in Ever Forward is provide a space for young men to talk about that emotional stuff that gets in the way. Like, I was angry a lot. Like, that one moment wasn't what made me run around the corner to go get that thing. Like, I had a lot of anger built up, but there was no release. There was no safe place to unload some of that baggage. So for our young men who are going through all kinds of things, if you're a teacher and educator and you work with young men, you may not even know their story. You may just think, this kid is silly, he's being funny, he's always laughing, he thinks everything is a joke. Sometimes the joking is a way to ignore the pain. Sometimes the laughing and the the being silly and the not worrying about the work is because I'm just trying to think about how to keep myself in this game. And when we kick them out because they didn't do their homework or because they're not paying attention, we're not knowing where their line is and where the edge is and what they're going through. Because nobody would have never known that I was dealing with drama at home all the time. So I'm going to close in a second, but I want to... Yesterday, we did a workshop at San Lorenzo High School. So our program is featured in a documentary called The Mask You Live In by Jennifer Siebel Newsom. And we did a workshop at San Lorenzo High School. They're actually where the program was started. So we haven't been there in several years, but we got back in the door. And the workshop is about taking off the mask and how do you give young men a space. And so I just want to tell you about, I'm going to just read one mask to you because one of them really stood out to me. So let's read this one. So in front of the mask is what they show the world. Like, you know, what we see. We all got this morning, got ready, put our mask on. Stepped out the room. But this young man, on a daily basis, his mask says, I'm together, I'm a resource, I'm strong. And then we talk about, like, what is it we don't show the world? What is the stuff that we just kind of ignore, we don't deal with, because it's too hard, it's too painful. And on his back, he said, sensitive, stressed, and scared. Now, I don't know if where you are in your life and where you are in your educational process or what youth you work with. But my job every day as a student was to come and pretend that everything was okay. Like, school was my safe haven. For some students, that's just a place to be away from whatever the other drama is. But depending on wherever you believe school is and why our students come to school every day, like, I would ask myself as a teacher, why do you come every day and do nothing? Well, because it's much more dangerous to stay at home. So how do we help to make a space for them to learn and to be feel welcome and feel wanted, but knowing that they got some other stuff? And I'm going to just read this quote. This is a reflection at the end of one of the young men. I don't know who it is, and none of them have names, so it's just anonymous. It says, today made me realize that other people go through things too. I used to think I was the only one. Being here helped to know that a man doesn't mean not crying or having emotion. It changed my way of thinking. And our work with Ever Forward Club is to provide young men a space so that they can deal with that stuff so that it doesn't trip them up, so that when something happens and you get angry, you can manage the anger in a way. But if it's already overloaded, if the pressure cooker is already steaming and you try and open the top without dealing with it, you're going to make a mess. And some of the messes can't be cleaned up really quickly. And I'll stop there. Thank you.
I'm going to share three stories today about three young men who shaped me as an educator and as a person. And I don't know that it'll add much to what's already been said, but I think it'll echo some of what's already been said, perhaps from a different perspective that maybe even more people in the audience started out like me, maybe, as an educator. When I first started, I think I was very much, when I look back on it now, like the kind of pop culture, mythological teacher that gets represented in the movies, the teacher on the white horse, often the white teacher on the white horse, and I was gonna save the kids, and I was gonna save the school, and I was gonna save the whole community. And I didn't think of it like then at all, but when I look back on my first year of teaching, I was, you know, I had all the things happen that happened to so many of us, you know, girls getting pregnant, and boys getting shot and sent to juvenile hall, and kids who are abused at home and who are homeless. But when I think back of how I looked at it then, I thought I was being supportive, but I would just come home every day and how hard this was for me, how stressed out I was. And I was a central actor in this narrative, but it wasn't my story because I wasn't the 14-year-old pregnant girl. I wasn't the 15-year-old who had to bury his friend over the weekend. And I didn't really see it that way then. It was at the beginning of my second year of teaching that I kind of got the wake-up call to my own kind of arrogance. I had given my American literature students an assignment, write about what the American dream is to you. And I gave them that on the first day of school, and I took the essays home, and I was reading them, and I was really surprised because they had all written, it doesn't mean anything to me. It's not for me. I'm Mexican. My family's from Guatemala, El Salvador. I'm black. The American dream is not for me. It's not for my people. And so I was really blown away by this, and I went back the next day and I said, I want to talk about this because this is not what I had expected. And they said, you know, Miss, you act like if we just work hard, we're all going to go to college and we're going to get good jobs and live in nice houses and safe neighborhoods and good schools for our kids. And it does not work like that. And I was like, no, you're too young. You got to have hope. That is the American dream. Just trust me. And then finally, there was one kid. He was only in my class for a week before he was arrested. And then I don't know what happened to him, but Joe, I'll always remember Joe. He says to me, Miss, when you go on your break to that little store across the street to get a cup of coffee, what's painted on the wall? And I said, well, a mural of the Virgin of Guadalupe. And he said, yeah, and what language do they speak inside that store? And I said, they speak Spanish. He said, look around you. You're in Mexico. This is our community, not yours. And in 20 seconds, Joe humbled me. And I, you know, just, it was like a slap in the face, but a good one, because in that moment, I realized what we all kind of say and know as educators, but it's, I knew it in a really visceral way that the best teachers are those of us who, and I'm still learning to learn this, but we go in knowing that we have much more to learn than to teach, much more every day, and that never ends. So Joe taught me about my ignorance. 5 years later, or my arrogance, 5 years later, I had another kind of very visceral slap, kind of, I call it my slap in the heart, really, when I kind of realized how kind of messed up our whole approach was as an educational system. I was still at the same school. I was an instructional coach. It was a school in South LA at the time, but there was no instruction going on that spring in the school because we'd had a series of lunchtime brawls that involved hundreds and hundreds of students. We, you know, locking down the campus, sending dozens of kids to the hospital day after day, to the point where we literally had police and riot gear stationed at our public school in South Central Los Angeles for weeks at a time. And I remember one day at lunch, a young woman named Mary, who was head of the Black Student Union, came up to me and said, Ms. Rhodes, why are all the adults afraid of us? You know, the students aren't beating up the adults, they're beating up each other. And I said, why do you say they're afraid of you? She said, no one smiles at us anymore. No one says hello. And so it was a really tense time. And the violence did not stop, even with the police there. It just moved off campus. And so one day after school, right after school, not right on the school property, but like a block away, you could see that there was a fight. And I mean, just hundreds of kids who were just like in the middle of the street, a block from the school. And I ran up and I pushed my way through the crowd and I saw a foot kicking a kid in the head, and then again, and I just jumped on that head. You know, I never saw the attackers ran away, and I never saw who they were because all I saw was that foot. You know, and I yelled at the kids, "Call 911! Call 911!" And this young man was laying on the ground, and he had, you know, blood coming out of his mouth and gashes all over his head, and he was barely conscious. The only way I could know he was conscious was because I took his hand, and he, you know, kind of squeezed my hand very lightly, so I knew he knew that someone was there. And I remember sitting with him, waiting for the ambulance to come, and it felt like a long time, and because we were in South LA, it probably was a long time, and thinking, oh my God, no kid should have to endure this on the way home from school. No kid should have to endure the spring of violence every day at lunch that our students were enduring. And I thought of my own daughter, who was not yet one at the time, and I thought, in a million years, I would never put her in this school. And I was so ashamed. I was ashamed for me and for all the adults in that school. And I thought, how have we let it get to this point? This is not right. But that wasn't actually, the real wake up on that one came about 48 hours later. I couldn't eat, I couldn't sleep. I would go into like an empty classroom like half a dozen times in the day to cry. And I went to one of the counselors at the school and I said, I can't keep it together, and how can I be here for the kids? Because I can't keep it together. She said, Shanley, you have PTSD. And I was like, no, because I wasn't a victim. That's for people who are victims. And I actually got to step in, and you know, I should feel good because I got to, you know, save somebody that day. She said, do you feel good? And I said, no, I feel overwhelmed. I feel depressed. I feel hopeless. I feel angry. I feel ashamed. She said, that's PTSD. And that was the moment where I thought, just like has been described here, oh my God, I have kids every day coming into my classroom, not just in the midst of all this violence that we were experiencing that spring, but every day, the whole time I've been teaching, kids walking into my classroom, feeling like I was feeling, barely able to keep it together, just thinking, praying that, can I make it through 1 hour without crying and letting other people see what I'm going through? And I thought, you know, how ironic and silly it is that we're like, let's learn some algebra, let's learn about the causes of World War I. And I'm an educator, I believe in the power of education, but in that moment I really realized that without looking at, you know, we talk about the whole child in preschool and elementary school, but in high school, you know, we talk about students and test scores and college prep and Common Core, and it's like, it's not just that algebra is sometimes at the bottom of the list. If you're going through it, algebra is not on the list. You're not going to get to algebra that day. And we don't account for that in our public schools as a system. So that kind of set me on a path in my career to create and find places to expand that look at students not as students but as people and are willing to, you know, take what comes in the door and say, we're not going to kick you out because you didn't do your homework, you know, or because you're acting silly in the back of the class. It's going to provide the kind of supports that these young people need so that they can get to the algebra eventually and can be like happy and healthy people. And I was fortunate to work for some years in conjunction with a nonprofit in Los Angeles called Homeboy Industries, and there my students were almost predominantly gang members and students in and out of the juvenile halls. So when I saw that Five Keys, which has been around a lot longer in San Francisco, but it started just a couple years ago in Los Angeles, when I saw that there was a school in the LA County Jail, I thought, this is great. I was so excited, especially because the longer I did the work, I would see my students age out of the juvenile halls, and they would be 18, and they wouldn't have a high school diploma, and they would hit the county, and you know, I was really glad that there was a school there. So I just want to finish with one story about one of the first students that I met when I started at Five Keys. His name was Alvin, and I met Alvin because he wanted to show me his transcripts. He had like 300 credits, but he hadn't graduated yet, and he was like, I'm going to be here about 6 months while I fight my case, and I want to graduate while I'm here. And he said, and he had been in the California Youth Authority, so he had been incarcerated for a long time as a minor, and he said, I don't understand why they kept giving me woodworking if all I needed was 8 credits of algebra to graduate. And I didn't want to tell Alvin it was probably because he had an IEP and his math fundamentals were not there, but I said, you know, we're going to make sure you graduate. And it was partly because I was really ticked off at the YA for not doing their job and getting this kid his diploma when they had had him for so many years, but it was also because I could see on Alvin's transcripts that he had gone to the school that I had worked at in South LA for so long, and he had gone there for 1 year, and it had been the year when there was all the violence. And it was a big school, there were like 4,000 kids on 3 different tracks, so it was no surprise that I didn't know him or he didn't know me, but I just made it up in my mind that I was gonna make sure that Alvin graduated because I felt, you know, it's the least I can do, because at that school we had failed so many students in so many ways. And so I worked with one of our special ed teachers and a math teacher, and we would take turns tutoring Alvin and in math. And in working in a jail, there's really kind of strict rules about boundaries, and you're not to like talk to students quite the same way you would in a regular school. You don't ask them their stories. But my curiosity finally got the better of me, not only because I knew what school Alvin had gone to, I could see his address on his former transcripts, his home address, and I knew that he, and I also could see from his tattoos, he was not someone who lived close to the school. He was not from the gang that controlled all the territory around that school, and I was fascinated that he had gone to that school for a whole year, because he had clearly had to take some great risks to get to school. So one day, I knew I couldn't ask him about it outright, but I just said, wow, you had to walk to school every day, which sounds kind of dumb, but it was kind of my roundabout way of prying a little bit. And he just proceeded to just tell me the story. He said, I went there, and one day some kids stopped me, and they said, you can't come here anymore, this isn't your school. And I went home and I thought about it and I was like, no, I want to keep going to school. I don't want to stop going to school. And so I went back the next day and they jumped me and they beat me up really bad. And I was at home for a week and I wasn't going to go back, but I thought, no, I really want to go to school and I'm going to be ready this time. So a week later I went back, and on the way home they came at me again, but this time I beat them up, and that's how I ended up in the YA. So I'm happy to say that Alvin graduated. And he graduated 3 days on the stage. We have we have ceremonies with the caps and gowns, and the sheriff will come and speak. And 3 days before he went to prison for 20 years, so he'll be in his 40s when he gets out of prison. And I think, just like I think about Joe every day and Victor, the kid on the street, I think about Alvin every day. And I think a lot of different things. I think, did I know the students who beat him up? Maybe they were my students. And I think, did I smile at him, even though I didn't know him, during that spring when I walked past him in the hall and make him feel safe, if only for like a split second, because clearly he was not safe at that school or coming to and from that school. And I'm really, really so fortunate and blessed to be a part of Five Keys, to be a part of the school that was able to finally help Alvin get his diploma. But Alvin shouldn't have gotten his diploma inside jail. He should have gotten it at the school that I taught at. And I think about my own daughter, who's 11 now, and who goes to public school and will go to her public high school, because I live in zip code 90041. And I don't live in zip code 90011 in Los Angeles. And that, when I think about the school-to-prison pipeline, that's the essential question. That's the root of it, and that's what gets me up every day and takes me inside the jail, because it should not matter that my daughter is in 90041 and someone else's kid is growing up in 90011. That shouldn't make a difference, but it does. So those are my stories.
Wow. Great. So thank you so much, all of you. It's really, there's incredibly powerful stories. I think when we start this work, the work that we're asking you to now go out and do and think about ways, create ways to disrupt the school-to-prison pipeline, you have to start here. And actually, I would encourage, if you're really thinking about sort of things that you're going to do in the world, you have to talk to the students. I mean, it's beautiful that Ashanti brought tangible assets from his kids, because you start to get a visceral sense. But there's nothing like sort of a firsthand experience. So this is one level removed. It's not exactly best practices, but those stories are really powerful and amazing. And thank you for sharing. I'm sure a lot of you have questions, and we have a mechanism by which there's microphones, I think, somewhere.
No,
oh, sorry, Lisa's going to take them. Catching up to speed. But we'll start with a couple of questions here just to kind of give you a sense of sort of how the conversation moves forward, typically, when you're in this kind of information gathering mode. And then we'll continue to take questions from the field. So
before your first question. So Liz is standing here, and some of the facilitators from the tables are going to, you have note cards on your table that hopefully you've been doing questions on. So please just bring them over to her and she'll feed them up to us. So that's how we'll get your questions.
Right. Sorry.
Go ahead, John.
Okay. So Tyson, I was super struck by a point that you made kind of again and again about relevance. And I'd love to hear you just talk a little bit more about the importance of when you're trying to connect with your kids. How do you, you have one advantage of being, of having some sort of built-in empathy, of being a black person who grew up in the neighborhoods in which you're working, but if you could talk just a little bit more about what that's like to sort of stand in the shoes of the people that you're trying to talk, to teach and to guide.
I think it's extremely valuable to have that, as was being mentioned in the story that you were talking about, or one of the stories that you had mentioned, how when you came into the school environment and the students taught you a lesson about, you described it as maybe an arrogance or a cultural arrogance or what have you. To be in that place, my father was a teacher, and I grew up around a lot of teachers, and I grew up in a program here in San Jose, which I think was a revolutionary program called the Jose Valdez Math Institute, Summer Math Institute. And so it started at Andrew Hill High School, and it evolved into this great institution of trying to help young children of color learn math and science and then move on or matriculate into colleges and universities. And it did a remarkable job of doing that, still continues to do a remarkable job of doing that. But like that, as an example, growing up and seeing that, It was young men and women that came from the same neighborhoods teaching the children that came from those neighborhoods. And there's a cultural fluency. And I'm not saying that everybody has to have that, but in that, like that, that's there's value in that. And we teach in schools in California and just throughout the United States where that valuation of that cultural experience, it's not there. Like I remember a story just a few months ago, they were talking about a textbook in Texas that had been put out as, a middle school textbook. And they were talking about, they described the transatlantic slave trade as Africans being brought over here like in search of labor. That is woefully incorrect. That is not how you describe that situation. And that's an essential part of the American historical experience, the Black American historical experience. If you want to talk about economics, you want to talk about anything from like a social studies lens, you have to understand the context of that. These people were not voluntarily coming over as labor migrants. That is not the case. And so if you have a school system that is recreating fabricated statements and saying, this is what you have to learn, like there's no relevance in that. And so then if you don't have people that can represent a relevance, it's a futile exercise, you know? And we're calling it education.
I have a question too. This is really for all of you. I mean, so much of the stories that we're hearing, and just thank you again for sharing the soul and the rawness of your real stories with us. It's an honor to hear them. Thank you for giving that to us. So much of what you're talking about, you know, it's if we kind of put it in traditional education speak, it's, you know, social emotional learning, and how do you combine that with academics, right? As I'm listening to you talk about, you were really redefining what it means to learn because you're putting those things together in such critical ways. So we're looking at the emotional aspects and the academic aspects and then trying to say, how do we re-engage these people in learning, which is what you're doing. And I would just love to hear a little bit more about, you know, how you think about those two, how you're you know, using those two things together in a very deliberate way, because clearly you are in your work and in your outcome.
I think, you know, teachers aren't therapists and they're not counselors. And I think part of it is that, you know, we need more structured kind of supports for students. And one of the programs that we're doing in Los Angeles for Five Keys, it's sponsored by the California Attorney General's Office, and it's a pilot program designed to reduce recidivism. And so we are able to give the men the high school education, they have college classes, vocational training, but they also, I think a key component is that they're assigned a caseworker, an MSW. And you know, it's just 81 men in a jail that serves 17,000 people. So it's but I think it's very promising because then they have someone where they can, you know, talk through their stories about, you know, how did I get here? And they also take a series of classes, cognitive-based intervention classes, that are designed to kind of help, give them the tools so that they can make better decisions and understand why they make bad decisions and you know, kind of cope with things when they get out. So I think that it's sometimes kind of parallel. And then I do think that there's a lot that can happen though, you know, with individual teachers inside individual classrooms and just with teachers in schools and that maybe don't have the resources that we're able to have those social workers work with our men. And I think a lot of it has to do with the consistency and the relevance and just being open to, you know, for me it was just like understanding that my life isn't like my student's life. And it's nothing in common, you know, nothing at all. So it was just being really willing to take them where they're at. And I think, you know, you also talked about like not, you know, they didn't do their homework. We're not gonna kick them out of class because, I mean, that's something that happens or like we suspend, and that, you know, it's like, okay, well then I'll just sit at home and not come back anymore. And so I think that there is a lot of things at different levels in the system that can happen to kind of keep kids in school and then also kind of deal with what they're bringing in, what they're carrying. Because, you know, an adolescent can't very well I mean, even adults can't deal with it all very well, you know, but an adolescent is not equipped to just handle their business when their business is so heavy. And so we have to provide those outlets.
Can you just repeat the main part of the question?
Wanted to hear a little bit about your experience of how you are sort of intentionally really blending sort of the social emotional piece with the academics, because you are trying to engage them in learning. How are you doing that, you know, given, you know, like the issues that Shanley just raised?
Yeah. Well, with EverForward, so when I was inviting students to come see me, I wasn't telling them, hey, come join this college prep club. And when I recruit students, we were looking for students who right now are like 2.0 below, or struggling with academics, you know, on the John Hopkins says the ABCs of early warning signs of dropping out, right? Attendance, behavior, and core classes failure, right? So that's who we're searching for. So when we go to a school, we're not trying to say, hey, how can we help you learn more? We're like saying, hey, you wanna have some fun? How about how do we help make school fun? How do we get the awe back in education? And if the awe is not there, why am I doing it? And I think I really appreciated what you said about, I think it's so important as an administrator, when I became a vice principal, I realized that, you know, so often teachers are so dedicated to their subject matter that they forget who they're supposed to be delivering the subject matter to. So it's kind of like, I need to deliver this lesson that I prepared, so beautifully crafted on my PowerPoint. And your job is to just sit there and take it in. And I think that what I had to do as an administrator, because I was a teacher for 10 years, is to be like, how do I tell this adult in a very healthy, that won't get me in trouble with the union way, that's not working. And they could care less about the War of 1812. Do you understand that somebody got shot on where these kids live, like yesterday? Do you understand what's happening? There's a war on their streets. And if you don't connect with the people who you're trying to deliver it to, it doesn't matter what you're delivering. I think there's a famous quote, right? People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And our educators have to know that. And as an administrator, that was my job, is to help our teachers learn the stories. Because it's not my job to tell them the kids' personal stories. But my job is to tell the teachers, hey, why don't you ask him what's going on with him? Why don't you bring him in for lunch? Ask him what's happening with him. And I think that we have to be doing a better job with the young men. Once you give the young men a space to, like, know that they're safe and they can talk about what's really going on and not be judged and not be made wrong, and let them let it off of their chest, they are so ready for it. They're so needed. It's biological that I got to get this stuff out. Like, it's only in this new day where we're believing that in our little house, we'll take care of everything.
Yeah.
Like, we used to live in communities where the neighbor would tell you, get off that fence, and you wouldn't be a problem. Now neighbors don't even talk to the neighborhood kid because they're afraid of them. Like, that's not community. And so our job is, where that social emotional piece is so huge, and it's the heart of our work. Like, when we come to a school, our first meeting with them is deep. This is the first meeting. We don't have time to sit here and overview stuff with you. Like, I know what's going on. But 90% of the people in jail are men. Is it because men are bad? No, it's because I believe that men don't get a space to be healed themselves. Because we're told that it makes you look weak, that you're a sissy, that you're gay, that you're whatever other word they can think of. You may know them. It makes you feel less than to have a feeling, and so we pretend we don't feel. Whatever, I don't care. Take my points. Call my mama. Pass me the phone when you talk to her. Maybe I can talk to her too. like those are the kind of messages you get because they need to hide. Mm-hmm. And so that's, I'll stop there with that. Yeah.
Thank you. Liz, I know you have some questions too from participants.
Yes. Okay. So there are a couple on these themes. So one from Kim Carter from the QED Foundation. What do you want or need from a white ally first? How can I, a middle-aged white woman, best help disrupt the system? And also Greg Garner from the Friday Institute similarly asked, as a privileged white male with a college degree, I struggle with how my own bias and unconscious prejudice prevents me from making a difference, from getting involved, white guilt, if you will. How should I address this and work to bring equity to educational environments?
I couldn't hear the question.
Yeah.
Can you repeat? It's a little hard to hear.
So basically, it's like people are asking, when you have a teaching population that is predominantly white, and in the U.S. particularly predominantly female, what do you do?
Really,
how do they address that?
That's the question?
Yes. I think that's how, am I right? Is that the heart of the question?
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Is Big Ideas Fest really capable of that conversation?
Go for it.
you tell me.
Well, I mean, the point is to have an honest conversation, right? And I mean, it's any question is on board here, right?
Really?
And okay. Be honest. I mean, you don't have to offend, but I mean, and we've already kind of cracked the door open on that conversation, right? So. I mean, please, let's hear your thoughts.
Okay. You want me to, I can speak on that a little bit. This is my opinion. The institution is offensive off top, like from the jump. So you're saying speak and don't offend. The institution is completely offensive with the way that it is structured from top down, the hierarchy of it, the way that students are allocated specific resources. So if we're going to be honest about that conversation, the thing needs to be rebuilt in a way that establishes equity for everybody. And that's not the case, and we know that. The stories that you're talking about with the student that you experienced and how, oh, there was an applause that was going on? But the story that you were talking about and your student and how these students should not have to obtain GEDs or high school certificates in jails and prisons. Like, that's a travesty of this society. When you treat specific children differently than other children are treated. Like, that has to be a fundamental understanding that we all arrive at. Like, we are dealing with a tragically broken system that does not operate correctly and does not operate with equity for everyone. Off top. Every day when we step in the classrooms, that's what's happening. And so when you have a teaching population that doesn't really reflect the population, especially here in California, because we live in a very diverse state, and depending on what region you teach in, whether it's Southern California or here in the Bay Area, you're gonna find a lot of the children that are in those classrooms that might be black or brown or might represent some other ethnic or cultural groups. There has to be some cultural fluency. And so the system reproduces the aspects of it that are broken by not reaching out to people that can represent that. And it's not saying that white men or white women can't teach. Not at all. That's not the reality. But when there is a huge cultural divide, and if the educational institutions that prepare teachers to go into those schools don't equip you with the skill set to learn that cultural fluency, how do you expect this institution to provide quality education for those students? It's not going to happen. So when black and brown students, be they male or female, are medicated more so than other students, or are dealt with punitive circumstances more so than other students, that school system is not trying to educate those people. That's not what it is. It's a housing facility where we have the school to prison pipeline, and that's why we have this language. Because so many young kids that go through these institutions do not receive what the stated goal of that institution is. And it's because it is constructed in a specific way and it self-replicates every single year. We have people who are in educational programs right now that are part of the self-replication process.
So I just want to make a, do you want to say something? Let me just say one quick thing here, which is that, you know, what we're going to do in a couple of minutes is begin sort of the second part of working at your tables around the brainstorming around what you've heard, around our design challenge, which is how might we, you know, develop education opportunities to disrupt the school to prison pipeline, right? So we're hearing these stories from this morning from people who are actually working in that pipeline, and I think and it's great to hear, you know, the first person narrative. We're sort of using them as our interviewees, right? This is your data. I mean, they're more than data, but in a sense, you're hearing their stories because you are whoever you are, whatever your context and color and culture, you're going to be designing for this today, right? So I just want to encourage in the spirit of saying, you know, please respond to the question And then, and again, it's really, we're not at the solution stage right now. We're at the learning stage of saying, what is your experience? And we hope you will all join one of these tables in a few minutes when we step down to actually engage in the process. But Ashanti, did you want to respond to that also?
Yeah, it was great. It was a great question. So I think for those who are interested in being allies, let me speak from the nonprofit side of me, right? This work that I started, and the reason I have a nonprofit now is that I wasn't trying to start a nonprofit. I was trying to get some kids to pass algebra. And so it came out of this need, as opposed to out of this, let me create a business. I don't even know, I'm still learning how to build a business. Like we don't have an accountant. We're doing everything very shoestring, very grassroots. And so I would say for those people who have, are in the culture of power, and who are interested in being allies, I would say you can go to our website, you can sign up to be a volunteer, you can help us get in those doors that I can't get in. Like, we're in Silicon Valley. There's billions of dollars here in Silicon Valley. And so what I always thought is if you do good work, people will come and support you financially. And I'm learning that that's not how business runs. You gotta market it, you gotta tell people, you gotta brag on yourself, and that's really hard for me. But I'm learning how to do it, and I need help at it. So if you are interested in getting involved, there's probably organizations you know about who need your access to the resources. Like there's people who know how to do the groundwork, who need people to help them do the other work to get it out there. There's no shortage of young people who are right now struggling. You can go to any middle school, any high school. I can walk down the hallway with you, and I can tell you, let's talk in with this young man right here. Like, you can see it in their face. And the fact that we're not doing anything about it, the fact that we keep putting it off for some later intervention, some other thing to work it out, then as educators, As educators, that was my man. As educators, we have a responsibility that when we notice it, like my job as a vice principal, I spent more time doing mentoring than I did disciplining. But as a vice principal, you need to be disciplining more because you got a line of people out the hall who wanna, who got referrals. And so our system is a system that has to be like, well, if I'm only supposed to be with you like 3 minutes to give you a detention and send you back to class, how do I deal with the fact that you're dealing with some emotional stuff that I can see on your face? And how dare I send you back to the, I'm gonna say wolves, because I mean, send them to the back to the war without equipping you with tools to be ready? And that's what I think we have to do.
Thank you. So can we just have another?
You want a couple more?
One more?
Okay.
Maybe just one more. I was going to ask for just one more appreciative show of applause for the panelists. But if you want to, do you have one more burning question?
Yes, this is an interesting one.
Yes.
So this is from Katie King at Knowledge Works. She wants to know, what role do you believe student-driven learning and student choice could play in disrupting the pipeline?
Thank you. Great question. What role do you think student voice? Other than the protest that we heard about at the jail. That was a good example.
I don't know, this doesn't really directly answer the question, but the first thing that comes to mind is kind of, for me, it's a lot about like understanding kind of the economic circumstances that that my students live in, and I'm not saying like we just say it's all about making money, but it's, especially when working inside the jail, we do want to have like a rigorous curriculum and Common Core and access to college, but I'm very, very mindful of the fact that when the students who are fortunate enough to leave the jail and not go to prison, they need to get work and they need it right away. So I think that in some ways it's like working with them on like what is it that has prevented them from being able to do that in the past, and how can we work with them and adapt our curriculum to be very, it goes back to that relevance piece. And that's something I think about a lot because, it's in theory, I wanna keep that college pipeline open for everybody, But the reality is that my students need to walk out of the gate being able to get a job, or I am going to see them back there. I mean, and that's not because they're bad people, but that's because people have to eat and they gotta put food on the table for their families. And so that is something that we're constantly trying to do, like work with students and hear from them, like what skill, what were you lacking that prevented you from getting a job, and how do we incorporate that into, and that's working with adult learners, so it's a little different, but that is something that I think about a lot in my current role.
I'll just say really quick about student-driven learning is that I always wanted students to drive their own learning, but I think that the fact that our classes are full has less ability. Like, if you want a student to be able to say, I want to learn this, and you create some lessons for them to do that, that requires more adults in the room. And so if we invest more money in schools than we do in prisons, then we can have more people in the room who are helping educate the youth. But when we expect one teacher to not only do differentiation, but also do individual learning plans for each student on a student-driven learning, from what I understand of student-driven learning, it's not even possible the way we have it now. I think that because there requires all, if there weren't all the requirements for, you know, what is it, the Smarter Balance, new test, so California has Smarter Balance, other states have other things, right? So we had STAR and we had that before, and so if all this stuff wasn't in the pipeline, then we could let them learn more creative things. But there's like the balance between keeping the district happy, right? So that, you know, you got your test scores are too low. Well, what do you want us to do? And so there's all these battles in education that, you know, it's hard work. And so our job is to figure out, how do we give students some autonomy in their learning, but also how do we make sure that they're covering what we held accountable for, right? And so I'll stop there.
Okay, Tyson, last word.
Yeah. So I think it's essential. It's very important to have student-driven learning. And like, going back to the way that our institution is constructed right now, it is done in a way where the input of the student, that voice is mute completely. And so in the classrooms, like in my classroom experience, because I'm dealing with an adult population, an incarcerated population, I know specific lessons that are gonna garner incredible amounts of enthusiasm because they are directly related to their situation. I'm teaching a government class right now. So anytime we go into the Constitution, we start talking about the Fourth Amendment, the Fifth Amendment, the Sixth Amendment, all the like civil rights protections, and you have a right to remain silent or anything like that. When we get like, oh, for real, that's what the Constitution says? I'm saying like, what does that say? Well, so my lawyer didn't do this? Like, I get, because it is directly related to something that is extremely important to them. And so if you do that, you can use that as a segue into other information. Like, once you have some successes with whatever the academic subject is, because it's something that they want to learn, you can build on it. Be like, oh, see how successful you are with it? See this, how this is connected to this. And then we can start building around that and developing a classroom environment where people are successful, people are engaged, and people are learning, and they're comfortable with learning. But like, that voice has to be there. So we have to have the students driving the curriculum to a certain degree, and then have teachers that are qualified and able to be in there and be a part of that cultural fluency and deliver that instruction and to be receptive. I mean, there's a lot of improv that has to happen, you know, in that.
Great, thank you. So this